بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. أما بعد، praise be to Allah سبحانه وتعالى and peace be upon Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. I testify that there is no God except Allah, and I testify that Muhammad is the Prophet and the Messenger of Allah. Brothers and sisters, once again Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses us to be from amongst those who gather in His house, and to be from amongst those that Allah Azza wa Jal wants us to seek knowledge. As the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, "Man yuridillahu bihi khayran yufaqihu fi ad-din," whom Allah Azza wa Jal wants goodness for, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will increase their knowledge in Islam. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bestow all His goodness upon us, and I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from amongst those who act upon what they listen and hear. Tonight is another night that we speak about another beautiful story from the Qur'an al-Kareem, a story that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala relates to us in the Qur'an al-Kareem, a story that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to reflect upon from the Qur'an al-Kareem. And tonight's story is the famous story of the two sons and children of Adam alayhi salam, Qabil and Habil. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes mention of this surah. Allah Azza wa Jal makes mention of the story in Surah Al-Ma'idah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says in the Qur'an al-Kareem, وَاتْلُ عَلَيْهِمْ نَبَأَ ابْنَيْ آدَمَ بِالْحَقِّ إِذْ قَرَّبَا قُرْبَانًا فَتُقُبِّلَ مِنْ أَحَدِهِمَا وَلَمْ يُتَقَبَّلْ مِنَ الْآخَرِ فَقَالَ لَأَقْتُلَنَّكَ قَالَ إِنَّمَا يَتَقَبَّلُ اللَّهُ مِنَ الْمُتَّقِينَ. Allah Azza wa Jal, He's saying in the Qur'an al-Kareem to the Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam, and recite to them and relate to them the story of the two children of Adam alayhi salam. And we know Adam alayhi salam is the first human being that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created with His own hands, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made him reside in the paradise. Then Allah azza wa jal descended him down from the paradise to earth. And Adam alayhi salam and Hawa, they lived on earth, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala started to bless them with children, which they became the children of Adam. And then all mankind and all the descent and race of mankind goes back to Adam alayhi salam. That's why Adam alayhi salam, he is the father of mankind. Everyone goes back to Adam alayhi salam, because all human beings are the children of Adam. All human beings are the sons and the daughters of Adam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as He mentions in the Qur'an al-Kareem about every prophet, لُكُلِّنْ جَعَلْنَا شِرْعَةً وَمَنْهَاجًا, for every prophet and messenger, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave a legislation and law. All prophets and messengers, they come with one religion. They came with the religion of Islam. However, they differ when it comes to the legislation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals to them. So prophets and messengers all come to call to Allah azza wa jalla, the oneness of Allah. But they might come with different legislations, they'll come with different rulings, they'll come with different laws. Not all prophets and messengers came with the same law and the same legislations. What's permissible in the legislation of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam could be not permissible in the legislation of another prophet and messenger. What's permissible in another prophet and messenger could be not permissible for the nation of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So to get this clear, all prophets and messengers came with one religion, and that's the religion of Islam. They came with one belief, one iman, one doctrine, and that's the belief and the iman and the doctrine of Islam. Inna dina inda Allah al-Islam, the only religion to Allah is Islam. But prophets and messengers differ with the sort of legislation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals to them. And here Adam alayhi salam, he is the prophet and the messenger of Allah, and he is a Muslim. He's no other religion but Islam. So he is a Muslim calling to Islam, and his children were also Muslims. And the children of Adam alayhi salam, they were following their father. They were following their father and their prophet and their messenger and their teacher, Adam alayhi salam. However, one thing that the religion or the legislation of Adam alayhi salam had that we don't have is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbids brothers and sisters to get married to one another, even though they come from the same pregnancy, or they don't come from the same pregnancy. So you are not allowed to get married to your sibling brother or sister. You are not allowed to get married to your sibling brother or sister. That's something that you find in all the other legislations beside Adam alayhi salam, even though you might come from different pregnancy, you're still not allowed to get married to your brother or your sister. You're not allowed to get married to your sister if you're a man. You're not allowed to get married to your brother if you're a woman. However, in the legislation of Adam alayhi salam, Hawa, the wife of Adam, she'll always fall pregnant with twins. And each time she falls pregnant with twins, it's always a boy and a girl, a male and a female. Now, it's haram in the legislation of Adam for a boy and a girl from the same pregnancy to get married to one another. However, it was permissible for a boy and a girl to get married to one another if they came from different pregnancy. So if a boy that came from one pregnancy, he's allowed to get married to a girl from a different pregnancy. And a girl that's from one pregnancy, she's allowed to get married to a boy from a different pregnancy. That's how it was with Adam alayhi salam. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbid that in the other legislations or in the legislations that are revealed to other prophets and messengers. Now, Hawa and Adam are living on the surface of this earth. And Hawa is falling pregnant. And every time she falls pregnant, she will fall pregnant with twins, a boy and a girl. And as I mentioned to you, the boy from one pregnancy will get married to a girl from a different pregnancy. And a girl from one pregnancy will get married to a boy from another pregnancy. But a boy and a girl from the same pregnancy are not allowed, it's forbidden upon them to get married to one another. Now Qabil, he had a sister, a twin sister. And Habil had a twin sister. And Qabil was ordered by his father to get married to the sister of Habil. And Habil to get married to the sister of Qabil. But the sister, the twin sister of Qabil, in which Habil is about to get married to, she was a lot more beautiful and a lot more prettier than the sister of Habil that Qabil was supposed to get married to. And Qabil wasn't too happy about getting married to the sister of Habil. He wanted to get married to his twin sister from the same pregnancy. But the legislation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed upon Adam alayhi salam does not allow that. You're not allowed to get married to your sister from the same pregnancy. You're allowed to get married to your sister from a different pregnancy, but your twin sister, you're not allowed to get married to her. And the sister and the twin sister of Qabil was a lot more prettier, as I mentioned, than the sister of Habil that Qabil was supposed to get married to. So Qabil went to his father Adam and complained to him. He complained to him and he said to him, I don't want to get married to Habil's sister. I want to get married to my twin sister. So Adam said, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not allow that. Allah only allows you to get married to a sister from a different pregnancy, not the same pregnancy. So Qabil insisted, and then Habil came and spoke to his father. So Adam suggested to his two sons, Qabil and Habil, if they want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give them an answer for Qabil to get married to his sister, then let them sacrifice a sacrifice. Let them give a sacrifice. Give a sacrifice for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give them a sign that will accept their sacrifice. And usually at that time, all the way up to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or maybe just maybe a few nations before the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whenever a believer would sacrifice a sacrifice to Allah Azza wa Jal, they will usually put it on a peak or on the peak of the mountain. And then a fire will descend from the heavens, will burn it, and that's a sign of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's acceptance to this sacrifice. Or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not accept the sacrifice, so Allah will keep it the way it is. So in other words, if someone wants to sacrifice a sacrifice to Allah, he will have to put that sacrifice, whatever item or object this sacrifice might be, he needs to put it on a peak of a mountain. And then a fire will come from the heavens, will burn it, and then that's a sign of acceptance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If no sign or Allah does not accept it, then Allah will leave it the way it is. So Adam alayhi salam, he tells his two children to sacrifice, to offer a sacrifice for the sake of Allah, and to offer the best they've got for the sake of Allah. So what Habil did, Habil was more righteous and more upright than Qabil. Qabil was more wicked, he was more impious than Habil. So Habil, he was a farmer, and Qabil also was a farmer. But Habil was a shepherd, he had a lot of cattle, he had sheep, he had goats, and that's the trade or that's the job that he was in. However, Qabil, he was a farmer. He used to plant crops and he used to harvest those crops and make money out of it or sell it or do whatever he needs to do. So Habil had cattle and Qabil had crops. So Habil, he chose the best of cattle that he had. He went and he chose the best sheep, the most expensive sheep, the most dearest sheep to him, and he sacrificed that for the sake of Allah. Qabil, on the other hand, he went and chose the cheapest. He went and chose the cheapest and the poorest crop and harvest that he had, and he sacrificed it for the sake of Allah. So a fire came from the heavens, took the sacrifice of Habil, and nothing came to the sacrifice of Qabil. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted the sacrifice of Habil, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not accept the sacrifice of Qabil. Habil was more righteous, Qabil was not righteous. Habil gave the best that he has and the best that he owns and sacrificed it for the sake of Allah. Qabil gave the cheapest that he had and the poorest that he had to offer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah Azza wa Jalla says in the Quran Kareem, وَاتْلُ عَلَيْهِمْ نَبَأَ ابْنَيْ آدَمَ بِالْحَقِّ. O Muhammad, relate to your people, relate to your nation the story of the children of Adam. إِذْ قَرَّبَا قُرْبَانًا. When two of them offered a sacrifice for the sake of Allah, فَتُقُبِّلَ مِنْ أَحَدِهِمَا. One, Allah Azza wa Jalla accepted their sacrifice, وَلَمْ يُتَقَبَّلْ مِنَ الْآخَرِ. And the other, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not accept his sacrifice. So Qabil became so jealous. First of all, he became jealous because now Habil is allowed to get married to his sister that he desires. And secondly, Allah accepted the sacrifice of Habil and did not accept his sacrifice. So Qabil became so outraged and he became so angry. And not only that, he became jealous and envious of his brother. So he became angry and envious of his brother that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted his sacrifice and he did not accept Qabil's sacrifice. And now Habil is allowed to get married to the sister of Qabil, who she is a lot more beautiful than the sister of Habil. So what did Qabil say to his brother Habil? لأقتلنك. I will kill you. I will kill you. And that was the first evil crime to be thought of by any of the children of Adam at that time. Up till then, there was no crime, there was no sin committed on the surface of this earth. Until that moment where Qabil decided or intended or even thought of committing such a crime or corruption or sin to kill his own brother, till that moment there was no corruption committed on the surface of this earth. There was no corruption committed on the face of this planet. So Adam alayhi salam was a prophet and a messenger, and his children were good people. The worst one probably was out of them is Qabil, but till that moment he did not commit a major sin. When he became so jealous and envious of his brother, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted the sacrifice of his brother, and Allah did not accept his sacrifice, and now Habil is allowed to get married to his beautiful sister, while Qabil cannot get married to his twin sister, he became so angry, he became so jealous, so he told his brother Habil, لأقتلنك. I'm gonna kill you. I'm gonna kill you. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, قَالَ إِنَّمَا يَتَقَبَّ اللَّهُ مِنَ الْمُتَّقِينَ. What was the response of this righteous man Habil? He didn't say, I'll take you on, come on, you wanna fight? I'll protect myself. He said, إِنَّمَا يَتَقَبَّلُ اللَّهُ مِنَ الْمُتَّقِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will only accept from those who are righteous. If you wanted Allah azza wa jalla to accept your sacrifice, you should have been righteous within yourself. إِنَّمَا يَتَقَبَّلُ اللَّهُ مِنَ الْمُتَّقِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only accepts the sacrifice of those who are righteous and upright. If you want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept your sacrifice, if you want Allah azza wa jalla to accept your reward, or to accept your deed, if you want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept your good actions, you must do it sincerely for the sake of Allah and you must be righteous. Because at the end of the day, Allah does not need your deeds. Allah does not need your actions. You're the one that needs Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if you want Allah to accept from you, you need to be righteous. You want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept you. You need to be righteous. So that was the response of Habil to his brother Qabil when he threatened him and he said to him that I'm going to kill you. He said, Allah only accept from those who are righteous. Then Habil, he says to his brother Qabil, and that's after Qabil threatened him. Now Qabil, the brother, he's threatening his own brother. And these two brothers come from a prophet and a messenger. So they are the sons of a prophet and a messenger. The first man that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created. So Habil also tells Qabil, لَإِن بَسَطْتَ إِلَيَّ يَدَكَ لِتَقْتُلَنِي مَا أَنَا بِبَاسِطٍ يَدِيَ إِلَيْكَ لِأَقْتُلَكَ. If you want to come and kill me, I'm not going to extend my arm to you to kill you. If you want to harm me, I'm not going to harm you in return. And this is the quality of the mu'min. He does not do a tit for tat. He doesn't just, you hit, I hit. You swear, I swear. The believer is bigger than that. As a mu'min, I'm bigger than that. I don't allow myself to fall in a sin if someone does a sin towards me. If someone does wrong by me, if someone wrongs me, that does not justify me to do wrong towards them. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the Quran al-Kareem, وَلَا تَسْتَوِي الْحَسَنَةُ وَلَا السَّيِّئَةُ اِدْفَعْ بِالَّتِي أَحْسَنُ. That bad and evil, bad or evil, is not equivalent to goodness. Evil and goodness are not equal. You cannot make those two equal. اِدْفَعْ بِالَّتِي أَحْسَنُ. Repel evilness with goodness. That goodness and evilness are not the same. Obviously, goodness is accepted by Allah Azza wa Jal. Evilness is rejected by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Goodness brings back goodness. Evilness only brings harm. And then Allah Azza wa Jal says, اِدْفَعْ بِالَّتِي أَحْسَنِ السَّيِّئَةَ. Repel evilness with goodness. Someone harms you, you do good towards them. That's what Islam teaches me. It's not always that if someone harms me, I harm them. Someone does wrong to me, I do wrong to them. And now Qabil, he is threatening his brother Habil by saying to him, I'm going to kill you. So Habil, he says to him, Allah only accepts from those who are righteous. And if you want to kill me or harm me, I'm not going to kill you or harm you. If you want to attack me, I'm not going to attack you back. If you want to fight me, I'm not going to fight you back. And then he says, إِنِّي أَخَافُ اللَّهَ رَبَّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Because I fear Allah. Not because I'm coward. Not because I'm coward. Because I fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not because I fear you. The only reason that I'm not going to respond back to you with evilness, and I'm not going to attack you the way you attack me, or fight you the way you fought me, or bring harm upon me, I'm not going to bring harm upon you, because I fear Allah azza wa jal. And that's the quality of those who fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the quality of those who fear Allah Azza wa Jal. Not always they respond evilness with evilness. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, respond evilness with goodness. If someone has been evil towards you, just be good towards them for the sake of Allah. Because you fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you fear Allah Azza wa Jal. Because the quality of those who fear Allah do not respond evilness with evilness, but they respond evilness with goodness. That's the quality of the mu'min. And that's one lesson that we learn out of this story that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning in the Quran al-Kareem. And he speaks about Habil because he fears Allah Azza wa Jal. Even though his own brother threatened to kill him, he said, I'm not going to harm you in return. Inni akhafu Allah Rabbil Alameen. Inni uridu an tabu'a bi ithmi wa ithmika fatakuna min ashabin nar wa dhalika jaza'u dhalimin. If that's the case, you want to harm me, then I want you to take your sins and my sins together, and Allah will punish you in the hellfire. If you want to attack me, I'm not going to attack you. You'll be punished by Allah Azza wa Jal for your sins, and Allah will also punish you because I did not respond to you. In other words, he's trying to remind his brother to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is not hyping his brother, and he's not agitating his brother. He is not motivating his brother, yes, if you want to hit, or he's provoking him. Because sometimes if someone is cruel towards you, you start provoking them. You want them to do something wrong to you. Maybe that will justify your wrong towards them. But here, Habil tells his brother, even though you want to harm me, I'm not going to harm you. And if that's the case, Allah will punish you for your sins. And Allah Azza wa Jal will also punish you because I did not harm you. إِنِّي تُرِيدُ أَن تَبُوءَ بِإِثْمِكَ بِإِثْمِي وَإِثْمِكَ فَتَكُونَ مِنْ أَصْحَابِ النَّارِ. I want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah Azza wa Jal will punish you for your sins, and for the sins of me not responding to you, because that's another sin on you, not on his behalf. وَذَٰلِكَ جَزَاءُ الظَّالِمِينَ. And this is the recompense, or this is the outcome of those, or the the outcome or the punishment that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give in return to those who are oppressors. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues to say, فَطَوَّعَتْ لَهُ نَفْسُهُ قَتْلَ أَخِيهِ فَقَتَلَهُ فَأَصْبَحَ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. Now, Qabil is becoming a lot more angry, a lot more outrageous. And not only that, he is so jealous, so envious from his brother Habil. Allah accepted his sacrifice, he did not accept his sacrifice. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed Habil to get married to his sister. At the same time, he wanted to get married to his own sister. So now Qabil is so angry, he is so upset, and he's so envious of his brother. And that's why envy, my brothers and my sisters, is the key to all evilness. That's where all division and disunity starts from envy. When a brother starts to envy his own brother, or a sister starts to envy her own sister. And usually you envy those who are close to you. You don't envy those who are distant away from you. People envy one another when they are so close. So the closer people are to one another is the more envious they become to each other. But that's not the quality of the mu'min. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he says, beware of envy. Do not envy one another. As he sallallahu alayhi wasallam describes it, the destroyer. And it destroys everything, like how a fire just destroys all timber and just burns all the wood. This is the envy that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam warns us. Don't envy anyone. At the end of the day, if Allah had written something more to someone else, that's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's decree upon them. And before you envy this person, remember that's Allah's decree. So it's like you're objecting on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's decree. Now Qabil is so envious, so angry from his brother. And then he started to plan and plot to kill his own brother. And that would be the first crime to be committed on the surface of this earth. That would be the first crime to be committed on the face of this planet. And he waited for the right time to see his brother Habil while he was looking after his herd and cattle in the middle of the desert. He was looking for the right moment to kill him. So he saw his brother Habil reclining and sitting down, and some narration says that he was sleeping on the ground resting during the day. So he grabbed a massive rock and crushed it over his brother. He crushed it over his brother's head and cracked his head, and Habil died. So now Qabil plans and plots. He attacks and strikes at the moment that he believes is right. While his brother is sleeping, he grabs a big massive rock and smashes it and crushes it over the head of his brother. And that was the first murder, that was the first killing that existed on the face of this planet. Before that, it never existed. In Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he says, from that time, from the time of Qabil that he killed his own brother Habil, to the day of judgment, any human being that kills another human being, Qabil will always get will also get the sins, and he also shares the sins with those who are killing other people. Why? Because he's the one that started it. Any person that kills someone in this world, any human being that kills any other human being in this world, Qabil will share the sins, because He says, how disgraceful it is upon me for me to be taught by a crow how to bury the corpse and the dead body of my brother. So he buried his brother the way the crow buried another crow. He dug up a hole and then he buried his brother. And that was the first soul to be killed, and that was the first body to be buried. And ever since then, as the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says in the hadith, from the descent and the progeny of Qabil, wickedness and evilness start to emerge. Wickedness and evilness start to emerge. The other children of Adam had a number of children. Most of them, if not all of them, beside Qabil and his progeny, they were righteous, they were good people, they were upright people. But from Qabil and Qabil himself and his progeny, that's where wickedness and evilness start to occur. That's where the wrong deeds and actions, corruption and evil deeds were committed by the progeny and the descent and the children of Qabil. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions this in the Quran al-Kareem. And what we learn out of this story is envy. Envy is an evil action, and it does cause corruption, and it distances those who are close to one another, and it turns the lovers against each other. And usually people envy those who are close to them. So you only envy those that you are close to, whether they are to be your brothers or sisters or cousins or your neighbors or your friends. If someone is strange to you, someone that you don't know of, you don't usually envy them because you don't have much of an interest in envying them. But usually you envy those who are close to you. And that's why, because of envy, envy escalates from a hatred within to an action, an evil action that comes out. And that what led Qabil to killing his own brother Habil. It's the envy that was inside him that became into an action that resorted to him and resulted to killing his own brother. Do not envy, as the Prophet Muhammad says, do not envy one another. La tahasadu. Do not envy one another. Do not look down at each other. Do not oppress each other. Do not turn your backs on each other. A Muslim doesn't envy anyone. On the contrary, a Muslim always wishes good for others. And if a Muslim sees someone with goodness, or Allah Azza wa Jalla blesses someone with a blessing, a Muslim wishes that blessing to prosper and flourish in the life of a Muslim. And there's difference between good envy and bad envy. A good envy is when you see someone with something good or a blessing that Allah had blessed them, and you wish goodness for them and you wish the same for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you. But an evil envy is when you see something good in someone, or Allah blesses someone with goodness, you wish that goodness to be taken away from him. You wish that goodness to be lifted away from him. That's an evil envy. So there's two types of envy. One envy that you see goodness or blessings upon someone and you wish Allah to give you the same. Not wishing for Allah to take this away from them. There's nothing wrong with that envy. That's what we call ghibta. But the evil envy is when you see goodness or a blessing upon someone, you wish that Allah takes this away from them, whether it comes to you or not, but you wish that this person does not excel in their life. And this is what we see in our time and age. This is what we see in our day and age, where people envy one another. People are becoming very envious. Nowadays, no one wants to see goodness in someone else. No one wants to see a blessing upon someone else, especially family members, the close ones. The brother doesn't want to see goodness in his brother or his family. The sister doesn't want to see goodness in her sister and her family. And subhanAllah, it only starts with envy, but it doesn't stop at envy. It starts with envy and someone starts to become envious towards the other and then escalates. It comes out of that, backbiting, slandering, fabricating wrong things about the others, fabricating false things about others. And then sometimes people escalate that into doing something, trying to harm this person or trying to put him down or even kill them, as Qabil did to his brother. And sometimes people kill one another because of envy. A lot of the murder cases that you hear about is because of envy. This person doesn't want goodness to this person. And this starts when a husband and wife break away from one another. They become so angry from one another, so outrageous of each other, and then they become envious, especially if one of them gets married. They become so angry and envious that they don't even hesitate to kill them. Wal'iyadu billah, envy. The Prophet ﷺ calls it al-haliqa. Al-haliqa means the shaver that shaves away your hasanat. The one that destroys away your hasanat, eats away your hasanat. This is envy, eats away your good deeds. Don't give your good deeds to anyone else. It didn't work hard for him for you to give him someone else. You worked hard for him for yourself. so you could save yourself from the hellfire. And iman and envy doesn't mix in one heart. Iman and envy does not mix in one heart. And that's why a true believer does not envy anyone else. And sometimes the sad thing about it is that even in the da'wah, amongst imams or amongst mashayikh or Islamic center, you feel that sense of envy, where this center envies the other center. And if another center is prosperous and flourishing, if another center is succeeding, then you find one center becomes very envious of them. Even in the da'wah. Even in the da'wah, one center envies another center. One jama'ah envies another jama'ah. And we're all at the end of the day working for the sake of Allah. What am I envying another center for? Why am I envying another mosque? Why am I envying another sheikh when I'm calling to Allah and he's calling to Allah? If another center prospers and another center flourishes, then that's something for me I have to be proud of, because they're my brothers at the end of the day. And at the end of the day, if they prosper, Islam prospers with them. If they excel, Islam excels with them. So why am I envious of them? And this is something that sometimes we see amongst Muslims. We're Muslims, we're talking about religious brothers, organizations, centers, mosques, envy one another. They don't want another center to flourish. One Islamic center doesn't want another Islamic center to flourish. One Islamic organization doesn't want another Islamic organization to flourish. They don't want them to excel. They don't want them to succeed. They want them to fail. Can't you get it? They are working for Allah and you're working for Allah. If they succeed, you succeed. If they flourish, you flourish. If they develop, you develop. If they go forward, Islam goes forward and you go forward with it too. So why are Muslims are becoming envious to one another? And Qabil became envious of his brother because Allah accepted his brother's sacrifice and Allah did not accept his sacrifice. So he said, لَأَقْتُلَنَّكْ, I'm going to kill you. And subhanAllah, that's what you see sometimes amongst Muslim organizations, because one organization becomes jealous of another organization and envious of another organization, so they start backbiting them, putting them down, fabricate wrong things about them just to put them down, to make sure that they lose followers or to make sure that people don't look up to them anymore. This is exactly what Qabil and Habil did. This is exactly what Qabil did to Habil. He was envious of his brother because Allah accepted his sacrifice and he did not accept his sacrifice. And this is the attitude that we have towards one another. One center wants to put down the other center. One center succeeds in something or becomes successful in something, the other one wants to put it down, wants to talk about him, wants to make sure that people turn against him. Let's wake up to ourselves. We are becoming Qabil in the da'wah. We are becoming Qabil in the actual da'wah. We're not even calling to Allah Azza wa Jalla, we're calling to ourselves. We are becoming Qabil in a suit of religious people. So Qabil from the inside and Abu Bakr from the outside, wal'iyadha billah. I should love what I love for my brothers. I should love for my brothers what I love for myself. I should love for other organizations what I love for my organization. And if I hear about a Muslim organization or an Islamic center succeeds or flourishes in something or prospers in something, I should be happy. Because at the end of the day, the da'wah of Islam includes us all, encompasses us all. My brothers and my sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to learn this story of Qabil and Habil, not to fall in the footsteps of Qabil, not to follow the footsteps of Qabil. We need to be someone who fears Allah azza wa jalla and wishes good for others. Love goodness for others, care about others. And if I see a Muslim brother succeed, that's success for me. And if I see another organization, another Muslim organization succeed, that's another success for me. If I see one Islamic center flourish, that's a flourishment for the entire ummah. Because this ummah is one body. This ummah is one body. If one limb is in pain, the rest of the body is in pain. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from amongst those who listen and hear, act upon what they listen and hear. Subhanak Allahumma bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Inshallah, I look forward to seeing you next Monday.